Good evening, brothers and sisters. I hope that you have had a wonderful day. It is a beautiful day outside. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. I just thank God for life and things being as well as they are, because they can be a lot worse than what they are. In the midst of all of this stuff that's going on, God is still good. He's good to all of us. If you can see me, if you can hear me, if you know that you're here, God is still good to all of us. And we just thank him for being God all by himself. Amen. And there is a word for this afternoon that we want to share with you. Amen. But before we get into our word, we're going to ask that you join us in a word of prayer. Dear Father, we come in the name of Jesus, thanking you for your grace and your mercy, and looking beyond all of our faults and seeing what we need, you being our God, our Father, a good Father, seeing everything that we need to live. You sustained us and you bless us even in spite of ourselves. Father, I ask that you bless your word, bless the hearers and the doers of your word today. These and other blessings we ask in our son Jesus' name. Amen. We'll try not to be with you too long this afternoon. We just feel good that we have a relationship with God, and knowing that God is still in the blessing business. Amen. Amen. Our word for this afternoon is found in Paul's letter to the church at Philippi, Philippians, the second chapter, that 14th and that 15th verse. 14th and 15th verse, second chapter of Philippians, that 14th to 15th verse. And it reads, "Do all things without murmurings and disputings, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world." Amen. And we like to use as a subject or a thought this afternoon, a good working attitude. A good working attitude. A lot of us, we complain so much about the things we do, the work that we do, and we have the bad attitude going in. We hate getting up in the morning, going to our job, seeing people on our job. But let's see if we would feel the same way. If you consider yourself a Christian, let's see, after this word today, let's see if we feel the same way. Amen. Amen. Jesus summarized our Christian life by saying, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." This is what Jesus says. If you will follow me, if any man will come after me, if any man will serve me, if any man will work for me, the first thing is let him deny himself. And after he's denied himself, then he can take up his cross and then follow me. That's what Jesus says. And in Jesus' teaching, it can be seen that the lives we lead in service to him are lives of denial to self and obedience to Jesus. However, even if we obey his directive, a question still remains: how happy are we about doing it? Or am I reluctantly doing this because Jesus says so? And when I say, am I reluctantly doing it, it means that I don't feel it. I don't want to do it, but because Jesus said so, that's why I'm doing it. Yeah, ask those questions. A life of denial means that we don't always get what we want. That's what, when Jesus said, you got to deny yourself, because if we had our way, we would just get everything or do everything we want. But if we have decided to follow Jesus, a life of denial means that you won't have it your way all the time. Life is not like Burger King, especially in the kingdom of God. You can't have it your way. It's the Lord's way. It's not your righteousness, but it's God's righteousness. See, this means that sometimes we have to forget about what we want in order to do what Jesus wants, because what may be pleasing to us may not be pleasing to Jesus. And if we are a follower of Christ, we have to do things that are pleasing to him. We may, that person on the job may want to get on our last nerve, but we got to live peaceably with them as life in us. We have to show that love of Christ in us. When he says in that last verse, ye shine as lights in the world. Jesus says, you are the lights of this world. Let your light so shine. Now, when he said that I am the light of the world, that means that he's in us. So we have lights in front of a guilty world. So that's the attitude that we must have. And this is what Paul is saying here. In knowing this, are we going to serve Jesus happily under these conditions, or are we going to serve him with complaining and arguing? Psalm 102 says, serve the Lord with gladness, come before his presence with singing. In other words, we should not look at serving the Lord as something that's tedious or something that's burdensome. Paul tells us that there are two things that we should not do when serving or working for the Lord, because I've heard a lot of people who claims to be called by God or who claims to have some kind of mission for the Lord, but yet they complain every step of the way. Because if you're truly a servant of God, you would thank him for everything that comes alive. I remember in Acts 4, when the apostles, when they were preaching Jesus after the Holy Spirit had come upon them, they were preaching Jesus, and the Pharisees and scribes, they whipped them, and they went away praising God that they were worthy to be whipped. Some of us would have said, well, I ain't preaching no more. I'm not saying anything else anymore. But they were shouting and praising God because they found themselves worthy of even being whipped for the gospel's sake. Sometimes you're going to be talked about. Sometimes you're going to be criticized. But you got to remember, as Paul says here, there are two things that you should not do when you're serving, even in the midst of criticism, even in the midst of people talking about you. There are two things that you should not do when you're serving the Lord. And I'm going to give these two, and I'm going to leave you alone. The first thing is, the Apostle Paul says that we should do everything without complaining about it. Lord, have mercy. He says in the verse, without murmuring, without complaining. Murmuring is complaining. That's what the children of Israel did when Moses brought them out of Egypt. They got in the wilderness and murmured. And what did God do? God punished them for their murmuring. He let the clothes stay on them. He gave them water from a rock. He gave them bread from heaven. He gave them flesh from the sea. Now, and they still complain. They still complain. And God said, because y'all want to complain and do all this stuff, I got something for you. I ain't going to let you get into the promised land. See, Paul says, whenever we're doing something for the Lord, we should not complain. We should not murmur. A lot of us, we got some growing to do, because even in the church today, even those folks who say that Jesus called them or God called them to do certain things, if you're complaining about the thing that God called you to do, you need to grow up. You got some growing to do. After all, if we had made the decision to follow Jesus, then we have also made the decision of following him. That following him is the best way to go in this life. That's what we decided. And it makes no sense then to complain about it. If you decided to, it was your choice to follow Jesus. Don't ever say, I ain't had no choice. I had to. No, it was your choice to follow Jesus. Jesus gives us free will. So it's your choice whether or not you follow Jesus. So it makes no sense to complain about it. If you decided to follow Jesus, don't complain about it. But what do we do instead? We complain. What makes sense is to take up our cross and bear it with a good attitude. Since I decided to do this, I better be motivated and know that I'm denying myself. It's not about me, but it's about Jesus. So since I chose to live this way, I'm going to be satisfied with what I chose to live. Paul says that he's been rich. He says, I've been poor, I've been hungry, and I've had everything that I need in life and to find the things in life. He said, but in all of my living, he said, no matter what state I'm in, I have learned therewith to be content. That's how you can go through life serving God with a good working attitude, when you have learned how to be content no matter what state you're in. You have learned therewith to be content, so you won't go through complaining. I remember Pastor Johnson singing the song about I won't complain. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some sleepless nights and all this stuff. But when I look around and see how good the Lord has been, my good days outweigh my bad days, and I won't complain. Paul says, in whatever you do, you should do it without complaining. Do it without complaining. If you got to complain, don't do it. But if you're going to follow Jesus, you got to take up your cross and bear it with a good attitude. And it may be hard. I'm not saying that it's going to be easy. It may be hard, but it's the way of Jesus. If you follow, Christianity is not hard. I don't know why folks still walk around saying that serving the Lord is so easy, being a Christian. So no, the way is hard, but you got to do it with a good attitude. It's going to require sacrifice. And sacrifice means that you got to deny yourself. You got to deny yourself. Paul wrote the church of Rome and say you got to present yourself a living sacrifice. It's a sacrifice that Jesus asks of us to give of ourselves. We have to be a living sacrifice. And if we're presenting ourselves as a living sacrifice, it's not about us. It's all about Jesus. So the first thing Paul said in working for the Lord and doing anything and everything, you got to do it without complaining. The second thing, Paul says that whatever you do, do it without arguing about it. Let me say that again. He said the second thing, do it without arguing. The first thing, you do it without complaining. Stop complaining. Grow up. The second thing, you got to do it without arguing. After all, if we love Jesus and trust his guidance for our lives, then it makes no sense to argue with him about what he wants us to do. What makes sense is to form arguments in defense of the direction that he has chosen, despite the difficulties and the obstacles. In other words, if we trust Jesus and trust his direction, then we should be willing to do whatever he has purposed for us without any question. There are too many folks who claim that the Lord has called them to do a particular task, and when they don't get the recognition that they feel that they should get, when they don't have their name called, or when they feel that the task is more difficult than they first thought, then they want to complain and they want to question Jesus. They want to question Jesus or argue with Jesus. Why are you doing this to me? Why do I have to go through this? You're not going to fly through on flowery beds of ease if Jesus bear a cross. That's why Paul put in his verse. He says, that's why Jesus says, if you're going to follow me, he says, first, you got to deny yourself, which means it's not about your glory. It's not about your name being called out. It's not about your popularity. You got to deny yourself. Then he says, take up your cross. Taking up your cross means that it's not going to be easy. It's a rough journey in taking up your cross. And he said, then follow me. If I deny myself, I got to forget about how I feel, what people say about me, wearing my feelings on my sleeve, getting my feelings hurt. I got to forget about all that. I got to take up my cross, which means I got to do what Jesus tells me to do, and I got to follow him. I got to try to live life as close as I can to the way that my Jesus would live. Yeah, that's right. There are too many of us. There are too many of us trying to argue with Jesus Why are you doing this to me? But yet we stepped on board saying, Lord, I'll go where you tell me to go. I'll do what you tell me to do. I'll say what you tell me to say. But then when the criticisms come, when the hard time comes, we want to complain. But we should have a good attitude saying, Lord, if you put me, if you led me to it, you'll lead me through it. And it's true that many of the great figures of the Bible complain to God on occasion, and we know about that. Moses complained about the children of Israel being hard-headed. We know that, and God had to assure him, they're not complaining about you, Moses. They're complaining about me. Job even complained that as someone who is as righteous or upright as he is, he shouldn't have to go through all of the things that he suffered. And then God responded. God responded in Job 38 and 2. And God said, who is this ignorant person saying these foolish things? Who is this person that's talking in this way and they don't have knowledge? You're talking without sense. As Job told his wife, he said, you sound like the foolish women. God is telling Job, you're talking like a fool now. If you're going to blame me or claim that I'm doing something wrong, it's perfectly acceptable to bring our cares and our concern to God if we're going through some things, but it is never acceptable to blame God or accuse him for doing wrong. God will never do anything wrong towards his people, but that will not exempt his people from the sufferings of life. And even in all parts of life, whether we're up or whether we're down, whether we're on top of the world or whether we're suffering, we still have to work with a good attitude. We still have to serve with a good attitude. Because if you have made a decision to follow Jesus and obey the will of God, then make sure that you perfect your decision with a good attitude. Have a good attitude about it. Can't stand these Christians that's negative. Can't stand these Christians that's always got to find some reason to complain or find some reason to murmur or to argue about something. When Jesus says, if you will follow him, the first thing you have to do is deny yourself. It ain't about how you gonna feel. It's about his glory, about God's glory. You have to forget about who you think you are. You have to forget about who you ought, what you think you ought to get. You have to forget about how people should act toward you. Serving the Lord is about your obedience. It's about your faithfulness. And it's about the belief that he's going to reward you at the end. You got a reward waiting for you when your work is done. And you will be rewarded according to your work. And guess what? Guess what? Not just what you do, but how you did it. Your attitude in what you did, you'll be rewarded for it. You don't want to reluctantly come before Christ and say, I did this. And Jesus didn't tell you, as he said in the gospel according to Matthew, yeah, I know what you did. I know you preached, you cast out demons, you did good work, but your work was of iniquity. Why? Partly because you had the wrong attitude. Yes, that's right. You had the wrong attitude. No matter what job you may have, no matter what task that lies before you, remember what Paul wrote to the church at Colossians, that third chapter, that 23rd verse. He says, and whatever you do, do it from the heart as to the Lord and not unto man. Whatever you're doing, whatever job you're doing, for him, work as though you're working unto the Lord and not unto man. I don't care how that supervisor acts. I don't care how your boss is. I don't care if they get an attitude toward you. Your job is to work as you're working unto the Lord. And remember, he has your reward. You're working as though you're working unto the Lord, and it should be with a good attitude. So if I have the attitude that I'm working for Jesus, then I can serve the Lord with gladness, and I can work with a good attitude. God bless you. May heaven smile upon you. I hope that we've said something that has encouraged you about a good working attitude. Because a lot of times we, as Christians, we want to complain about, oh, woe is me. I'm going through this and I'm going through that. But if it's for Jesus, I'm going to be satisfied. If it's for Jesus, I'm going to find joy in doing it. If it's for Jesus, I know that there's something better on the other side. So I'm going to serve him with gladness. That's how my attitude is going to be. It's going to be a good working attitude. On my job, in my church, in my home, it's going to be a good working attitude because I know who my boss is. God bless you. God bless you. We've enjoyed this word. Sometimes we have to be reminded of who we are because Paul said we have to be a light in this world. We have to be a light in this world. And the only Jesus that some people are going to know is the Jesus that you show them. And I'm not talking about in church when everybody's saved on Sunday, but I'm talking about on Monday afternoon, right before you go to work. And that little person right there getting on your last nerve. Are you going to show them Jesus? Are you going to show them Jesus? Amen. God bless you. We want to thank you again for your blessings that you have given in this ministry and supported this ministry. And we ask that you continue to do so. We will be back the second Saturday in November, which will be October the 10th at 10 o'clock. The trustee committee will be there for tithe and contributions. And we pray that you come and do your diligence. As unto the Lord, amen. You send with you one of your deacons or one of the members who are heading there, and if you are mailing it in, that address is Mizpah Baptist Church, Post Office Box 1275, Baxley, Georgia 31515. That is again Mizpah Baptist Church, Post Office Box 1275, Baxley, Georgia 31515. We thank God for our time we have with you today. And remember, Monday is the last day to register to vote. And if you don't know whether or not you're registered, if you hadn't gone and tried, go online and just type in the identification bar, am I registered to vote? And it'll give you a website where you can type in your information. I found out that since I moved and changed cities, that, and you know, even though you left that other address, your registration is then in the next city or the next county. So make sure you check where you are to vote, because we want to show anything that they can do to try to get your vote not to count. That's what they're going to do. So make sure you have all your ducks in a row. Make sure you dot every I, cross every T, and go out and vote. Let your voice be heard. God bless you, and we hope that everything is going well with you. Stay safe, wear your mask, do what you're supposed to do. COVID is still out there. We're not out of the woods yet. I feel that there's a bright day coming, but we're not out of the woods yet. We're going to keep trusting God, doing what we're supposed to do. So God bless you. Have a great afternoon. I love you. Can't wait to get back to the house with y'all. So take care. Take care of yourselves and each other.